Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Good afternoon. First, let me introduce myself. My name is Muhammad Naufal Rahmatullah from Universitas Sriwijaya. I'll be responsible for hosting parallel session today and the next day. I'm glad to welcome all presenters who will present their work. Before we start our parallel session, let me explain about the session rule. First, all presenters will be given 15 minutes for presenting their work and 10 minutes for question and answering session. The question and answering session will be conducted after the presentation of each presenter. If the audience wants to ask question, you need to select the icon raise hand and then the operator will unmute you. Or you can write it down in the chat box. The question should be brief and clear. And please mute the microphone when you are not speaking. The parallel session will be divided into 2 days. For today's session, we will have 7 presenters, and tomorrow we will have 3 presenters. Without further ado, I would like to welcome our first presenters. He will deliver a presentation entitled Ontology Construction Automation from Unstructured Text Data Using Creation Extraction Techniques on Family Medical Plans. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Rian Rahmanda Putra. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you for the moderator. Please share my presentation. Okay, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon for all the participants in the room meeting for the parallel session this afternoon. I'm Rian Rahmanda. I will share to all of you our research about ontology construction automation from unstructured text data using relation extraction technique on family medicinal plans. My research team, there are Husnawati from Indo Global Mandiri University, and then myself, Rian Rahmanda from State Polytechnic of Sriwijaya, and also the last one is Ichat Mirani, is also from State Polytechnic Negeri Sriwijaya. Okay, next. Okay, next. The background of our research is why we do this research because. I'm sorry, moderator. Next slide. Next slide again. Next slide. Okay. The background why we do this research is because, as we know that Indonesia is the second largest country that has a wealth in the biological resource, but Indonesia still depend on import medicine because many people do not know the efficiency of the plants around them as a medicine. Whereas the knowledge about the medicinal plant, there are so many information in the internet or in the form of website and or Wikipedia in a form of free text or unstructured text. We can show the knowledge of medicinal plant in the form of ontology. However, to form the ontology using large text data will take time and effort because it requires the extraction of knowledge. Ontology can be constructed automatically with extraction knowledge from free text. Instance, we can build an ontology to produce the instance. We can do some relation extraction technique to get a structure from unstructured free text data to get instance that is used as a component to form an ontology. Next slide, please. Next slide, please. Now, to form the ontology automatically, we have built some model. We have built a model As you see in the slideshow, there's a pre-processing part, and then there is a pre-processing part is consisting of sentence segmentation, because we know that raw text is usually in form of paragraph, and paragraph is contain some sentence, and we do some sentence segmentation. After that, we do some tokenization to split the word in the sentence, and then we doing some parts of speech tagging, or we labels the word based on its class, or is where is it now, noun, verb, adjective, and etc. And then after we have tag in the each word, we do some entity detection. Entity detection in our research, entity detection technique that we use is NP chunking atau non-phrase chunking, or in Bahasa Indonesia you call it frase nomina. And then after we get the entity, we use NP chunking. We do some relation detection. The term relation in this in our research refer to a word that between entity. So usually relation is a verb. Usually relation is a verb. And then after we do some relation detection, we have instance in the form of tuple consisting of non-phrase, relation, and non-phrase. And then after that, we to make a better instance, in the last NP or non-phrase, in the last non-phrase and the last entity, we do some pronoun resolution to substitute the word like it's, there, and something like that to the subject before. And then after that, we do some clustering to form an ontology from the instance that we have built before. Okay, next slide please. Okay, for evaluation of our method, we use the reference ontology to compare a resulted ontology with the reference ontology. As you can see in the picture, this is the reference ontology that we get from research from Rahmawati. There are some ontology about plan, but it's not actually in a especially medicinal plan. We already search about reference ontology and the medicinal plan, but we don't get the specific about medicinal plan, but we think it's have a similarity, because it's also a general ontology for a plan. And then next slide please. We doing some various scenario. The first scenario is we using different value threshold similarity in doing clustering process. The similarity value that we use are 2.25, 0.25, 0.5, 0.75, and 1. Clustering method that you use is agglomerative clustering. And then after we use the different clustering process, different clustering threshold, the second scenario is clustering with the only considering on relation with without considering the type of entity. We don't, and then we use the clustering in considering both relation and type of entity in the tuple. Okay, next slide. Result and this discussion. Okay, from the ontology result that we compare with the reference ontology, this is the ontology that we result. There are so many. There are two. There are two ontology component that is not there. There's not find in the reference ontology. Yeah, instance warna dan waktu. This is ontology that we resolve from the automatic construction. Next slide. And from the experiment result, with the experiment result with the scenario based on the similarity the with considering the type of entity parts, this is to measure the quality of constructed ontology. We use variable cluster purity and relation concept. Cluster purity is we check the how pure or how granularity of the instance that happened in that in this one instance. And then the relations concept, it's about the relation in the one cluster, in the one cluster. From that result, we have a conclusion. Next slide, please. The next conclusion, the best method or the best scenario to construct ontology automatically is clustering based on relation and type of entity pair from tuple using threshold value 0.225 of similarity. With this scenario, we can get recall value of 75%, the precision value of 57.14%, the cluster priority value is 79.82%, and the relation concept value of 98.57%. Okay, that's all my presentation. I give it back to the moderator.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Rahman Putra, for his informative and interesting talk. Now we will open the floor for a question. Any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Is there any question for Mr. Rian Rahmanda Putra regarding to his presentation from audience? Okay, Mr. Rian Rahmanda Putra, let me ask several questions to you.
Okay.
In your slide, there are some steps that you used to perform the ontology construction, and one of them is name entity. Could you please, what is the algorithm that you use to perform name entity?
Name entity is in entity detection.
Entity detection. Sorry.
Oh,
yeah, that's right.
Entity detection. Actually, in entity detection, actually, I use only a simple algorithm. Entity detection is doing by process the word that already tag. So we have already worked with the tag. So for example, we have my My research, our research is actually using Bahasa Indonesia. So I will use a sentence in kalimat Bahasa Indonesia. For example, jeruk mengandung vitamin C. From that sentence, we have all already sentence segmentation. We separate the word from that sentence. Jeruk. Jeruk mengandung vitamin C. There are four sentence, and then for each sentence we doing some tagging with some an NLP technique, but in algorithm I don't build the algorithm for speech tagging. I use the open source from the previous research. And then from the part of speech tagging, it's result a word with its word class. For example, that jeruk is noun atau kata benda, mengandung itu verb kata kerja, vitamin is a noun, C because it's a standalone word, it will tag as a noun. So name entity is with I use NP chunking with regex, our regular expressions approachment to group the pattern based on its tag. For example, the algorithm, if it's already in the one bracket of NP chunking, then we don't need to use it again. For example, jeruk is already one because it's separate by verb. So jeruk is one NP. It will be recognized as an entity. Because it's a fit that rule that I use as a regex or regular expression based on the tag, and then mengandung kata word mengandung in the next word it will not tag as an entity because is a verb, so it will be passed and then. From the next word is vitamin C. Vitamin C is noun and noun, so it will be chunk, will be group, become one phrase atau one phrase nomin atau satu phrase nomina. So from that sentence we get two entities. The first is jeruk and the second is vitamin C. Then a relation between that entity, because the word from between that entity is mengandung, so the relation will be mengandung because it's verb. If the between that entity is adjective or in Bahasa we call it kata sifat, then in that sentence or in that paragraph our algorithm will not recognize as a instance to form an ontology. Is that my answer is clear or not?
Okay, thank you very much for the answers, Mr. Rian Rahmanda Putra. Okay, we still have time for Mr. Rahmanda Putra presentation. Is there any question from other audience? Please your chat it in the chat box. Okay, thank you, Mr. Rian Rahmanda Putra, for your presentation. Next, we will continue our presentation to the next presenters. Our second presenters, we will deliver a presentation entitled On-Time Predictions of Students' Graduation Period Using Data Mining Technique. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Kanda Januar Miraswan. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you for Mr. Nova Rahmatullah for the chance. I'll start to share screen. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I will introduce myself. My name is Kanda Januar Miraswan from Universitas Sriwijaya, and my paper is in the title of On-Time Prediction of Student Graduation Period Using Data Mining Technique. And the author, I'm the first author, Kanda Januar Miraswan. The second author is Muhammad Ali Bukhari. The third author is Rizky Kurniati. And the fourth author is Anna Dwi Marju Salina. So, in my paper, I have a topic about on-time graduation of a student. This graduation period is important aspect in evaluating the success of the education process in the university. Why? Because when many students are graduate on time, our accreditation will be good. And how to classify it? Yeah, by using a prediction, by using a historical data, by fine pattern or model using several data or other variable or unknown type or value. And based on the consideration of the prediction and the classification algorithm, the algorithm that used in this data mining technique is ensemble random forest. This is the background why I use on-time student graduation period. The study deadline in this maximum time limit allow for the student to complete their studies is called study deadline. So in student, they have study deadline. For undergraduate program, it must be finished by 8 semester or in the maximum for 14 semester or 7 years. And undergraduate program education is said to be on-time graduate if it success in 8 semester or below 4 years, and it will be called and not on time or it late if it exceeds 8 semester or 4 years. So in this research, I use data mining to classify student that will be on time or not on time by using previous data that already have in this faculty. Selection from the raw data will in the selection will be become a target data, and then it will be do some pre-processing to become a pre-processor data, and it will be transformed into transform data. From the transform data, it will be used for data mining technique to find pattern, and from the pattern we can use interpretation or evaluation to make some policy or will deploy what can be do in the future. And the method that I use is random forest. So the random forest is basically a random basically a decision tree. So it will be have many decision tree that will be created by using ensemble technique. From the tree, the decision tree itself is have some ability to have some classification from previous data, and from the decision tree we use random forest technique to put from many tree that already we built to classify some data. It will be classified into on time or not on time in student graduation. And in this methodology, I use Scripps DM, where this is start from the business understanding, data preparation, data modeling, evaluation, and then from evaluation we can recycle again from business understanding or further more until we come to last evaluation. If the evaluation is good, we can deploy what data mining policy that can we do, and all of these are come from the data that we already have. So in the data mining we find information that valuable from a bulk of data, and from that bulk of data we find an interpretation, and from that interpretation we can make some policy or some good strategy to make our university to be better in accreditation or any other quality of the university quantization. And from the first step is business understanding. So the university quality can be measured by ratio of student that graduate on time and the ratio of number of student who graduate not on time or even drop out. Greater the student of graduate on time, it will make the quality of the university become higher. How to make the quality of the university become good? By using by doing some periodic monitoring and evaluation. This is very necessary to be able to provide beneficial policy. The second step is data understanding. The data that we use in this research are Judicium data from the 21 to 34 student batch in University of Sriwijaya from year 2009 until 2030 from Faculty of Computer Science in Universitas Sriwijaya. The record that we have is total 1013 record, and the attribute that are there in that data is name or ID, entry age, entry path, GPA, study program, length of thesis, gender, regional origin, study period, and the graduation. Next, the step is data preparation. From the data we already collect, we can do cleaning by clean some missing value. So the data that was have a missing value will be clean, whether this is can be replaced or it can be deleted. From the change, the name and the NIM are discarded because it have a unique identity, so it can be used in the data preparation. And the graduation are the attribute that are result of prediction and for classification. This graduate are come from a study period using a rule that study period is called on time if it has X semester or less. If it has study period that are greater than 8 semester, it called on, not on time. And then from the data, we do some dividing by from the initial data set by using 10-fold cross validation. So the all the data that already prepared will be divided into 10 batch, and in every batch, one batch will be used to be classified, and the other will be used to data training, and it will be done to all the 10 batch. So the all batch will be have one chance to be a data testing, and the other will be used as data training. And this is the next step is modeling. From the modeling, we have the data set and we will do some processing to get a new data set. Then we will have a modeling technique from the training data to from the training data we do some evaluation from the data testing, and from the data testing we can have result of accuracy. And then evaluation. This process conduct by evaluating one of many model that already built and determine whether there is model that meets the objective at an early stage. And this stage, we use RapidMiner to test the accuracy by using a classification method, performance measurement, by averaging the result of the 10 cross-validation method. And the last step is deployment. From the analysis result, we can have a policy that can be produced to lead a solution that can be taken into consideration in the decision support system. And that this policy can be used to be to use by study program or faculties or a university related to the problem of the student who have the potential to graduate not on time. And this is the experiment and result that I already conduct. So from the input we have in the research, we use judicium data as many as 1013 data. And then from the initial data, we do cleaning data by clean some missing value or maybe replace a value that or that can be replaced. So after cleaning, we have 1875 record consisting of 156 record of on time and 719 records not on time. And the dataset of the modeling process consists of attribute of entry age, path of entry, GPA, study program, length of thesis, gender, regional origin, study period, and one target attribute, namely graduation. The graduation comes from study time. And from the result, we do 10-fold cross-validation to measure the result. The model prediction accuracy was measured using different number of tree in the random forest method. And this is the result from the tree. We do many variable number of tree from the random of forest. And here we are get that the average of the accuracy is 90.74%. And from this table, we see that using number of tree of 23, we get the maximum result of 91.31%. And from the weight attribute analysis, the weight was obtained as follow, that from every weight that we already, from the attribute that we already have, the length of thesis have a weight that matters for the graduation not on time or not on time by 0.2, and then study program is 0.14, and the GPA was 0.081. And from the conclusion, the data mining technique with random forest method can be applied to predict the accuracy of on-time student graduation period. And the average prediction accuracy of the on-time student graduation period is 90.74%. And the attribute that was have a major role in the determining the accuracy of the on-time student graduation period are the length of the thesis, study program, and GPA. That's all from my presentation. I will give back to moderator Mr. Naufal Rahmatullah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much Mr. Kanda Januar Pirasman for his informative and interesting talk. Now we will open the floor for question. If you have any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. To all audience, if you have any question, please your hand or you can write it down in the chat box.
Revan, raise the hand.
Okay, thanks to the moderator. I want to talk about random forest is the one of algorithm that have capability in in case of imbalance data. Is it right?
The random forest to yep. imbalance data. Yes, because it will generate many tree from.
Okay. The question is, there is a condition that the data have imbalance in the data that use. I mean, in bahasa, apakah ada kondisi di mana data tersebut imbalance pada data yang digunakan?
So what do you ask is there any case that my data is imbalance? That's your question, right?
Yep.
Okay, from my data, actually this is still not imbalance because from my data, wait, I check it back. Okay, the data that I have is 800, and on time is only 156, and the not on time is 700. So this is we can call it imbalance. For the random forest, still can handle it because the model can create many tree. As I already present, I use 5, 10, until 43, and because we can create many tree, we have many model that produce, and from that model we and the random forest will have a vote with a majority will give. We can get a classification from the majority of that many model or many tree that we already create. So in my research, this can handle imbalance data, or although this is just maybe the ratio is 1 to 5, yeah, just 1 to 5, not 1 to 100, just 1 to 5. This is maybe still called imbalance, but not so really imbalance. And the result is over 90%. So in my result, this can be the random forest technique can handle the imbalance data. Another option you can use like a sampling technique. So the data will be increased by using synthetic data. So maybe the last one, the on time one, we can use synthetic data. So the ratio is 1 to 1. We can do something like that if you want. That's it.
Okay, thanks, Mr. Kanda.
You are welcome. Thank you for your question.
Okay, we still have a time for Mr. Kanda Janur Miraswan presentation. Any question from the audience, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, Mr. Kanda, actually I have a question for you. As you state in your research methodology, you use a 10-fold cross-validation to evaluate your work. But unfortunately, I can't see the 10 cross-fold validation on your result. Please, can you explain how the 10 cross-fault validation result regarding to your papers? Thank you.
Okay, thank you for your question, Mr. Noval. Yes, in my research, I use 10-fold cross-validation, but in here, I use tool by using RapidMiner. But actually, the process of 10-fold cross-validation is by dividing the data to 10 batch. So in one batch, it will approximately have like 87 data. So from the 87 data, we use this as data testing, and the other maybe the other 800, it will be used as data training, and all of the batch will be used as data testing. So the second batch will be used as data testing, and batch 1, 2, 1, 3 and until batch 10 will be used as data testing, and it will continue to all batch until batch 10. So the batch 10 will be used as data testing, and batch 1 until 9 will be used as data training. From all the testing that we already conduct 10 times, we get accuracy of each batch, and from each batch we calculate by using average of all accuracy from batch 1. We have accuracy until batch 10, we have accuracy, and we have average of all data. So we have average of the 10-fold cross-validation result. Does it this mungkin, maybe this is what I can explain to you, Mr. Noval.
Okay, thank you very much for the answers, Mr. Kanda Januar Miraswan.
You are welcome, sir.
Okay, we still have time left. Is there any question for Mr. Kanda Januar Miraswan regarding to his presentation? Okay, thank you, Mr. Kanda Januar Miraswan, for your presentation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome our third presenters. He will deliver a presentation entitled Indonesian Sentiment Analysis Using Deep Learning Convolutional Neural Network and Word to Fact for Product Review. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Revan Muhammad Dava. The floor is yours.
Hey, thanks to the moderator. Let me introduce myself. My name is Revan Muhammad Dava. I am informatics engineering student in Faculty of Computer Science, Sriwijaya University, and I'm also a member of Artificial Intelligence Group in Sriwijaya University. Our research is about Indonesian sentiment analysis using deep learning convolutional neural network and word to fact for product review. The first author is Dr. Abiansa, and the second is me, Revan Muhammad Dava. Analyzing sentiment in Indonesian product review from the marketplace is a complex problem. The review from Indonesian marketplace usually contains a lot of rating errors, such as typographical error, misspelling word, and imbalance label of rating in the review of product, and variety of the sentence length, such as short sentence or long sentence. These are some examples of review from Lazada. There are two examples of the review. The review one is BRG should be barang, enteng should be ringan, BLM should be belum, mudah duaan should be mudah-mudahan, tuk should be untuk, and the others. This is only some of examples that exist in our dataset. The Indonesian Sentiment Analysis of Product Review Study. The first article is Indonesian TV Rating Prediction Using Support Vector Machine and Engram by M.A. Fauzi. The first article explains the methodologies to make a prediction system using SVM and Engram feature. Bigram feature get best performance of SVM result, and the model with two category in rating have a good performance then 5 category in the rating. And the second article is improving analysis of short informal Indonesian product review using synonym-based feature expansion. This article try to solve the problem of short sentence length in product review data by using external corpus for expanding the word of feature. The category API are used for this research. Based on the result, the future expansion with category API is insignificant when the data gets bigger. The third article is analysis sentiment review barang berbahasa Indonesia dengan metode support vector machine dan query expansion. This article is similar to the second article, just using the support vector machine as the classifier. And the fourth article is what to fact model for sentiment analysis of product review in Indonesian language. This article try to compare TF-IDF and both feature extraction with what to fact model. The classifier that are used is support vector machine, and the experiment's results show that SVM can perform well on the sentiment analysis tasks. However, the what to fact model has the lowest accuracy other than baseline method including back of word and TF-IDF. So the research 1, 2, 3, and 4 not explain writing error in the product review. The research problem that are generally discussed are the performance of the model in sentiment analysis. In this case is knife-based method and support vector machine and TF-IDF feature and engram feature. The problem that was specifically discussed was the sentence length. Based on the research 2, feature expansion does not significantly affect the performance result on a relatively larger amount of data. Apart from that, the amount of the data set is also relatively small. The research one is only using under 1,000 data, and research two is using 1,100 data. Research three is only using 400 data, and research four is only 772. Several studies have used CNN and Word2Fact in the case of general Indonesian sentiment analysis. Is in article 5, sentiment analysis Indonesian Twitter based on Word2Fact using a deep convolutional neural network by Has Duyanto. The model performance get best accuracy of 76% with the number of data sets is under 1000. And article 6 is Word2Fact for Indonesian sentiment analysis toward hotel review and evaluation study. The model get performance of average accuracy is 92%, and the number of dataset that is used is 2,500. In deep learning, a convolutional neural network (CNN) or CoffNet is a class of deep neural network. Since it is a deep learning method, the amount of data used will greatly affect the ability of the model. However, several previous study use a relatively small amount of the data. Of course, this can cause the model to fit under conditions that are prominent in the dataset. Our research, this study provide a large size dataset for specific domain on Indonesian product review. We also analyze the performance of the convolutional neural network and Word2Fact with the characteristic of sentence length and pre-processing steps. We collect the dataset from the Lazada website using web scraping technique. There is over 5 million review from 1,050 categories. The number of review with rating 1 is over 100,000, and rating 2 is over 900,000, and rating 3 is over 100,000, and rating 4 is over 200,000, and rating 5 is over 4 million. The data used for the experiment consists of 5 million review, which contain a lot of typographical error and linguistic phenomenon. Some of linguistic phenomenon are slang word, misspelled word, and incomplete word. Furthermore, the length of sentence in the review also varies widely. Table 1 is some of linguistic phenomenon in the dataset. As you can see, the example of slang word is mantul, in Indonesian, mantap, moga, markotop, and the others. We split the dataset for training the Word2Fact that is all of the review, and for training and testing convolutional network that is 200,000 positive review and 200,000 negative review. This is because there are over 4 million positive review in the data. So this step carried out to balance the label of the data. The experiment used two characteristics. There are sentence length and data pre-processing. The sentence length has three categories. There are sentence under 5 or word under 5 and medium sentence that are word in between 5 and 10 and long sentence that are word over 10. And data pre-processing is divided into two stages that are normalization only and normalization with stopword and stemming. We using Sastrawi library for stopword removal process and Nazif Adriani algorithm for stemming process. There are 6 combination that follow table 3 as table 2. The convolutional neural network architecture that we use is proposed by Kim. The architecture of convolutional neural network consists of convolutional layer, mask pooling layer, and fully connected layer with dropout and with dropout. The parameter of CNN are mask feature with 100, window size with 3.3 and 4 and 5, but size with 64, epoch with 200, callback is early stopping, and dropout is 0.5, activation function is ReLU, optimizer function is stochastic gradient descent, loss function is binary cross entropy, subsampling is max pooling, and we use TensorFlow Keras library to implement the convolutional neural network model. And for the word-to-fact architecture, we use Skipgram architecture with hierarchical softmax evaluation method and the vector size of 100. According to Nawangsari, hierarchical softmax provide better result, says during the training process using a binary tree model to represent all of the word in the vocabulary. And furthermore, to obtain the optimal value of the accuracy, then we should increase the vector dimension and amount of the data simultan. We use GenSim library to implement the word-to-fact model. This is the result of the model performance. Figure 3 is the effect of the text length on accuracy value, and figure 4 is the effect of text length on IOC value. Long text have the highest accuracy value, but the long text have the lowest IOC value. And the medium text have quite similar AOC value and accuracy value, and short text too. The best performance based on accuracy metric was obtained by the long sentence with n over 10, with significant difference in accuracy of the long sentence compared to medium and short sentence. Medium sentence have an accuracy of 70%, while short sentence have accuracy 70.36%. The accuracy metrics only measure how good the model for making true prediction. Based on the AOC metrics, the best performance of model was obtained while training with short sentence data with 72.24%. A higher AOC score means that the model performed well in making correct prediction for each positive label and negative label, which in this experiment predict positive sentiment as positive and negative sentiment as negative. This shows that although the accuracy of the short sentence is the smallest, the models trained with the short sentence produce a better performance for predicting each label correctly. In addition, the big difference in the number of label also affect the model in predicting one label better than other label. This is of course a challenge because product review are problematic with data imbalance. Besides that, each category on the label also contributes to how this data imbalance problem can be more complicated because each category generally has review with certain word characteristic. The example is, the lamp is very bright and the lamp is very dim. The word bright and dim will be easy to find in review with the tools product with the tools product category, but not in other category. And also the padding operation that we use add factor 0 to the sentence factor, which has a word length below the maximum word length. This causes the factor generated in long sentence with range n over 10 to be erratic. It turns out that the maximum word length in a long sentence is 160. We can see that the accuracy and AOC with a fairly close difference are obtained from the medium sentence. This is because the number of label in medium sentence is quite similar and the word length in a sentence is in a relatively stable range. This is the effect of pre-processing step on model performance. The figure 5 show that constant effect on AOC and accuracy, where is AOC and accuracy in additional stopword removal and stemming process that increase the model performance. Accuracy and AOC model with only normalization process get 73.93% and 71.4%. Accuracy and AOC in model with normalization, stopword removal, and stemming get 73.38% and 70.90 69%. Stopwatch removal in Sastrawi Library only contains 126 stopwatch. Moreover, stemming with Najib Adriani algorithm have a high cost. It took a long time to pre-process large dataset. Almost half of vocabulary in this dataset has frequency 1. And maybe it affects the structure of the stopwatch. Stemming process with Najib Adriani algorithm using rule-based method based on the morphological of the word. The problem of writing error becomes a problem for normal stemming algorithm. Understanding the problem with data characteristic is very important. Sentiment analysis on product review requires a series of other steps, such as correcting word, filtering the number of label, and the length of the sentence also affect the algorithm used to extract its feature. The general data preprocessing state does not improve the model performance. Moreover, the Najib Adriani algorithm took a long time to process a large dataset. Convolutional neural network with word-to-fact model have a good performance while training with data that contains a lot of linguistic phenomenon. The word-to-fact model is the recipe for the classification result by the convolutional neural network. However, this factor can become biased if there is mishandling on padding operation in convolutional neural network. The dataset size does not guarantee that the model will perform well when using the deep learning model. Therefore, it takes a pre-processing state that can handle problem with data that contain writing error. This is our dataset. If you want to access to my GitHub, Revan Muhammad Dava, Indonesian dataset SIML, that contain 5 million review. Okay. Thanks. I give it back to the moderator.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Revan Muhammad Dava, for his informative and interesting talk. Now we will open the floor for a question. If the audience have question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, for audience, if you have any question regarding to Mr. Revan Muhammad Dava presentation, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, Mr. Revan Muhammad Dava, I have several questions for you. The first question is, as we know that word embedding technique is sensitive to out of vocabulary phenomena. How do you avoid that phenomena so that your model, your word embedding model, your word effect model is capable to handle the OOV phenomena? And the second question is, could you tell us the architecture of convolutional neural network that you use? Because along with your presentation before, I can find any information about the CNN architecture. I think that's my question. Thank you.
Okay, I will try to answer. For the question one is OOV problem. We can train the model with all of vocabulary that contains in the dataset, or we can transform if the data that has not access in the model. In this paper, I train the model of word-to-fact using all of the vocabulary in the dataset. So the OOV problem is not appear in this research. And for the question two, the architecture is simple convolutional neural network proposed by Kim. There is one convolutional layer, one mask pooling layer, and vanilla layer, and the last is fully connected layer with dropout. And the parameter of the CNN, you can look at my presentation. I will present again. This is the parameter that I use for the convolutional neural network architecture. With one convolutional layer, max pooling layer, and fully connected layer with dropout. In the convolutional layer, we use 100 max feature, and there are three size of convolutional window size. There is 3, 4, and 5, and we use baud size of 64, and IPO is 200 baud. The training process of the model is not reach to 2000 epochs because the callback function is early stopping. So if the train If the train is going to overfitting, if the train is going to overfitting, the train will be stopped. And for the optimizer function, we use stochastic gradient descent, and for the loss function, we use binary cross entropy, and subsampling layer that use is mass pooling layer here. And maybe this is my answer. Is there any question? Is there any question? Anova.
Okay. Thank you for your answer, Mr. Revan Muhammad Dava. Actually, about the convolutional neural network architecture, we determine the input size to the architecture, right?
Right.
So could you tell us how many features that are fit into convolutional neural networks, and how do you what your approach to handle the different length of sentence in your data set? So as I see in your presentation, you are divided your text into three groups, right? First is a small sentence, and then medium sentence and long sentence, I think. So could you tell us how you perform how you make the features same for all three group of sentences? I think Mr. Revan have technical difficulties. Our technician will help him join this breakroom game. Okay. Okay. Mr. Revan, okay. Are you still there?
Yeah, I'm sorry for the...
Okay, it's okay. So did you still get my question regarding the features?
Yep, I will answer the question. We use the padding operation to make the input size is same or similar or in same of the data set. And it to be erratic problem if the sentence have a long or have a wide range in the sentence. If we use the padding operation with zero adding factor, it will produce a high bias feature if the sentence have a wide range. We only use that padding operation, but the padding operation maybe can be improved to make the feature is more powerful. Because of the, if the sentence of length is very wide, it can make the feature of the word vector more have height bias. Okay. Maybe it is my answer.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Refan Muhammad Dafa. Okay. To all audience, we still have time for Mr. Refan Muhammad Dafa presentation. If you have any question.
I have information too. The API from Lazada have another data that's not only review, but you can explore the API from the Lazada and Shopee. There are some other data that can be collected from that API.
Okay, thank you for the information, Mr. Refan Muhammad Dafa. Okay, so the audience, we still have time for Mr. Refan Muhammad Dafa. If you have any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Refan Muhammad Dafa, for your presentation. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome our fourth presenters. He will deliver a presentation entitled The Effect of Weights on Deep Convolutional Neural Network with Supervised Learning to Play 2048. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Rahmat Fadli Isnanto. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you for the host, for the chance. Now I will present our presentation. The title is The Effect of Weight on Deep Convolutional Neural Network with Supervised Learning to Play 2048. And then the author is, the first author, Nabila Rizkia Auditia. Second author, Rosi Pasarella. Third author, Reza Firsandaya Malik. And four other, it's Huda Ubaya, and five other, it's myself. And the six other is Julie Rose Kauris. For the introduction, actually all of us maybe already played the game. And then the game is an activity that usually involving person skill, knowledge, or chance, and the player of the game engages in artificial conflict defined by rule, and the result is quantifiable outcome. And then the neural network is implemented in many fields such as computer game players. The implementation of computer game player with neural network has been recorded in many architecture type. And one of the method we put interest to solve is published by Naoki Kondo and Kiminori Matsuzaki. The title is Deep Convolutional Neural Network Trained by Supervised Learning with the study case using game 2048. Okay, for the game 2048 is an addictive single player puzzle, but statisticated player on four equal four board. It's developed by 19 years old Italian web developer. The name is Gabriel Chiarulli in 2014. And based on 1024 by V2 Studio and conceptually similar from The Trees by Asher Vollmer. This game is using the slide, the tiles using four arrow K-ups, so we can slide to up, down, left, or right to create a tile with number 2048. And then if there's legal move, the game is end. Okay, this is the board game preview. It start for two tiles placed in random position. Then the probability of the tiles value is 2 is 90% and the tiles value is 4 is 100%. So to understand how the game moves, stick focus for the highest number in the corner and will change of the tiles of the highest lowest time tiles. The game will be end if we get the 2048 in the corner. Okay. And then for the methodology, we use deep convolutional neural network. It's a deep convolutional neural network. It's a type of neural network used for multidimensional processing. And the term of deep in general is a collection of several networks with a convolutional layer. And then for the supervised learning, is an application where the training data consists of example of input vector that are adjust to target vector by utilizing label on the data. By adjusting the target vector, trained data use as knowledge and will be validated during the test process. And then the 4-week initiation, it's the formula of the week initialization that used for DCN and architecture, assumed from the channel number of the connect to each layer. Hence, the week number can initialize from the layer and the channel number. And then from the previous paper, the research maintained to keep the weight number are the same range with the channel number modification for every layer. So weight number could stay in the range between 800, 1000 until the 800, 2000. It's found that the architecture will with the 5-layer DCNN so the best result. So basically we use layer 5 from the previous paper. And then for the methodology, for the weak initialization, we use enhancement. There's a weak enhancement 25%, 50%, 75% until 400%. And then for the data resource, we get the training data of 2048 has been recorded by Professor Kiminori Matsuzaki from Koichi University of Technology with total 600 million data acquired from 54,000 gameplay it's divided into 60 files. And then for the data, we took only 2 data from every line to learn model DCNN play game for 2048. So we took last direction of layer selection and the last pop up tiles position. So for the analysis, we divide enhancement number of the week into 2 stakes. The first stake, we divide the week number, it's between 25% until 100%. And then the second stage, it's from the 100% week until 400%. So we use the training model from the first and the second stage of training to play 1,000 games and compare the result to find the weight of impact. And for the training result, in the first stage, we found that the best result in for the accuracy, we found the accuracy 74.90%, and the loss is 54.1%. And then for the second stage, the accuracy is 76.2%, and the loss is 51.70%. And then the result for the testing, we found the average score is 111.180 with the ratio 88.90%. And then the second stage, we find the ratio it's 90.70%. And for the conclusion, the deep convolutional neural network method combined with the supervised learning approach is suitable for learning how to play game in 2048 achieve accuracy for the 76.2% and the loss for 51.7%. From the learning phase, the learning parameter are used again for the completion of the 2048 game and get the highest average score of 118.344 and the completion ratio of 2048 tiles as much as 90.7% from the 100 gameplay. And the increment of weight of number on DCNN believes the more information that learn could improve the machine learning performance. Okay, I think that's all. But that's all my presentation, and thank you for the host.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Rahmat Fadli Isnanto, for his informative and interesting talk. Now we will open the floor for a question. Any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. To all presenters and audience, if you have any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, Mr. Rahmat Fadli Isnanto, it seems that I will start the question regarding to your presentation. My question is, what is the label or the target of your convolutional neural network architecture?
Okay. For the target, the label, actually, this one, we only focus on the two label, two model, and the label, there's a lot of more label, it's the last book of tiles position. So it's 0, 8, 3, and 13, and more. Is there any question?
So is it the movement of the players? So if the players move the tiles to up and then level is zero, for example, or if the players goes down and then the level will be one?
Actually, this game, if we move, this is the example of the game. If we move these two tiles into the random or we move the swap up and then the new tiles will be pop up. For example, we move the two into the up corner and then the new tiles will pop up. It's 2 or 8 or 4. It's something like that.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Rahmat Fadli Isnanto. And I think I have several suggestions. For example, in your presentation, you say that you have 55.70% of loss. While your accuracy is above 70%, right? Is that correct?
70%, okay.
Okay, I think your loss score is not that high since your accuracy numbers is about 70%.
Accuracy number is about 74% and the loss is 54.
Yeah, that's right. I think your loss is not 45.1%.
I think it's the accuracy and the loss, it's different thing because the accuracy, how to say, explain that the loss is based on, there's a lot of parameter that we use before. I already told you that the last poop up tail position. So the loss is basically their they collect all the error, all the error from the this last poop up tiles position, while the accuracy is, I think they using all the, I'm sorry, yes, the accuracy, while the accuracy, they're using all the correct position, all the correct number. Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Ahmad Fadli Isnanto, for your answer. Okay, we still have time. If you have any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box regarding to Mr. Rahmat Fadli Isnanto presentation.
Good afternoon, the honorable examiners, advisor, and audience, thank you for your giving me for this opportunity to present the journal A Tile Third, an air quality prediction of Jakarta using quadratic discriminant analysis. Background. Unheard of air quality and can cause heart problems, decrease efficiency, finance less economic problems, and ultimately leads to social problem. The air population index, IPE. Is a number of focus on effect on human health, aesthetic value, and other living thing that it given place and time define the state of ambient for quality. The APU's official in Indonesia in the air populating standard index standard pencemaran udara abbreviated is PU. PU is calculated and stimulated by the head of the environmental impact management agency, degree of Ministry of Environment number 45. Less men and half. Last my 19 27 cancer sending our populated starting index and degree of heart of an environmental impact management agency number 117 of 1997 detected November 21. The SPU was detected mine by changing each other of the five indicator of air population indicator measure into a dimensions number. The five indicator are particulate matter 10 microgram PM10 sulfur dioxide SO2 site sulfur dioxide SO2 9 nitrogen dioxide NO2 ozone O3 and carbon monoxide CO degree of also stipulated 5 air qualities in Indonesia healthy moderate unhealthy very healthy and hazardous. Jakarta is one of the world cities wide unhealthy air quality even during an epidemic. This statement favor to air quality. No monitoring is Jakarta in January 2020. Research related to APA air quality or its categories has been carried out. Research methodologies, data of research. The standardized data is in from daily air quality data for January 1, 2017 to December 31, 2019 and south from http://data.jakarta2.id/data-asset+. The data consists of 1,945 observation point from PM10. SO2, NO2, and O3, and air quality categories. Research tags. The research tags in this word are given in figure 1, like this. Data pre-processing consists of planning process, data screening. Comes up like ASEAN checking consists of normality Gaussian test, homogen test, and equality test. Modeling an unquality of prediction use discriminant analysis consists of terbagi menjadi consists of parameter estimation modeling using the parameter and validasi model measurement the performance using accuracy sensitivity CTF1 score and precision. Norover M2, M2, M3, M4 are second there an over and four central moment. The null hypothesis of ambient is that the likelihood of each class has a Gaussian distribution. The hypothesis rejected if the p value is smaller than the site significant level. The decreasement function for the two models we are x1 bar percentage 1 mean factor 1 gt class and cg represent the covariance metric of the GT class. The data used for following modeling were 27/2/2018 data 65.7%. Table 1. Data's percent on modeling and validation like this. Three assumptions need to be tested by before the modeling process is carried out. Normality, homology, and the equality of the vector mean test. Table 2. Normality test of learning did like this. The Gaussian exemption are often violated. Table 3. Homogeneities of composition metric like this. The mean factor quality test using PLI 3 in table 4 now that the value of 2.2 times 10 minus 6 is smaller than the significant level of 0.101. Table 4. Equality test of mean factor like this. The parameter was estimated using maximum likelihood estimation. The table also present its other categories. Fire probabilities, which is a bit of time compared to the number of observation in each categories with tutorial observation. Table 5, model parameter, like this. Table 6, for performance for classification. The 10 more, the model was built using the parameter in table 5 and valid using date from January 1 to December 31, 2019. The performance measures of this model are presented in table 6. The performance measurement of air quality in INDEC present using the discriminant essentially analysis in these words is category as very good. Where the accuracy performance measurement of this prediction is 93.84%, speaking 96.18%. At the same time, the sensitive for F1 score present have the same rate of 94.41%. The accuracy of the air quality prediction result, which QDA of 93.84%, has a difference of far less than 1%, which that opponent who predicted white air quality in California with 94.1% accuracy with the dial by Isis Franklin Function RBF methods. This results better than who managed to achieve an accuracy of 72% in predicting air quality Wuhan, China, using use close model granulation. It is hoped that the relevant of important and success in predicting air quality in Jakarta will help reduce air population critical for critical impact on citizen and the environment. Conclusion. Discriminant analysis can be used to predict the categories of dairy and quality Jakarta well. Although not all class or categories fulfill the Gaussian estimation. In the healthy categories, all variables are Gaussian distributed. But in another categories, not all variables are Gaussian distributed. However, the five performance measures used evaluated the models, namely accuracy, specificity, sensitivity, 5-1 score, and precision. Show in high score with more than 90%, the score indicate very good performance. This effect also indicator not all very well, very neat Gaussian distributed. Not all categories need to have Gaussian distribution. Variable to obtain every good level of Jakarta accuracy. Thank you for your attention. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Mr. Winato Chandra, for his informative and interesting talk. Now, we will open the floor for a question. If audience have any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. So all participants, if you have any question, please raise your hand. Or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, Mr. Winato Chandra, I have a question for you. My question is, in your presentation, you use data for ...2017 to 2018 for training data, and 2019 for the validation or testing data. My question is, how do you obtain the data? Since your paper title is air quality forecasting in Jakarta area. So how do you obtain the data? Thank you.
Thank you for your attention. Apa? Thank you. Yeah. One question. Excuse. Let me to answer. Testing data. How opening the data. For the first, I'm looking for the data from Jakarta. The three step. Pertama, the first I get from like this, bukan like this. Wait a minute, tunggu sebentar.
Okay, take your time.
Modeling and validity of prediction using instrument analysis parameter estimation modeling using parameter validation model, yeah. And then the second measurement refer using accuracy sensitivity, and the third more formula moreover M2, M3, and 4 scanned the third, four, and four central moment, use the moment. And then we get one before good. That is from three, we got the one better good, yeah? Significant level. Where the discriminant position for the two models, one model, one bar represent the main vector in the GH class, and SG represented the confidence metric of in Jakarta, something like that.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Winoto Chandra, for your answers. Next, thank you, Mr. Winoto Chandra, for your presentation also. Next, yeah. We will continue our panel session to our sixth presenter. He will deliver a presentation entitled Word Embedding for Eligibility Classification of Clinical Trials Document Using Deep Learning. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Jasmir. Jasmir, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Noval. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
I am present a part of my dissertation and the detail about embedding for eligibility classification of clinical trials document using introduction. Clinical trial is a test of the efficacy of the new drug in humans, which was previously initiated by animal testing or preclinical testing. Basically, clinical trials confirm the effectiveness, safety, and description of the side effect that often arise in human due to administration of a drug. Using healthy or sick human in Mr. Noval.
Your slide is not appear in our monitor. Please share screen your presentation. I'm sorry for the interruption.
Okay, I'm sorry.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Jasmir.
Yeah. My name is Jasmir. I want to present my a part of my dissertation in the title "Word Embedding for Eligibility Classification of Clinical Trial Document Using Deep Learning." Introduction, a clinical trial is a test of the efficacy of a new drug in humans, which was previously initiated by animal testing or preclinical testing. Basically, clinical trial confirm the effectiveness, safety, and description of the side effect that often arise in human due to administration of a drug. Using healthy or sick human in experiments is justified in medical science because it will benefit the public at large to understand the effect of this drug so that they can be used in the wider community with more confidence about their effectiveness and safety. The subject of clinical trials will be discussed in the include classification clinical trial in the study, including classifying clinical trial document in the form of free text and ensure that the document fall into one or more predetermined categories. This text classification already have many useful applications in the field of sentiment analysis, spam detection, subject categorization, precise sentence, and so on. With the success that deep learning has had in some cases, such as visual and speech recognition, many deep architectural models have been implemented to address various issues in LLP, so that better performance can be achieved. Text classification has also attracted the attention of researchers to continue to develop innovation and testing, including those sorts from clinical text commonly referred to as clinical trials. Multilayer perceptron is the most usual topology of artificial neural network, where the perceptrons are connected to form several layers. And MLP has an input layer at the last one, hidden layer, and the one output layer. The term MLP is used ambiguously, sometimes loosely to any forward ANN, sometimes strictly to refer to network composed of multiple layers of perceptron. In this case, the MLP model has one input layer and one hidden layer. The number of nodes in this model varies depending on the number of input and output. The number of input neurons depends on the number of markers and the number of hidden neurons. Then this network is trained and validated by k-fold cross-validation. The aim of this study was to construct a classification model of eligibility criteria from clinical trial statement and use it to train and validate model that predict whether a short free text statement is considered an eligible or not eligible criteria for this trial. We also analyze the obtained word embedding representation and were able to identify similar treatment. This is a research framework, clinical trial dataset, and then text preprocessing, and then word embedding, then labeling, and the last multi-layer perceptron classifier. Data were taken from a clinical statement, extract from clinical trial protocol on cancer, which can be downloaded from http://clinicaltrial.gov. We use 100,000 data available as a trial using Python. Text processing state is the state where the application select the data to be processed in each document. This pre-processing process include cache folding, tokenizing, filtering, and stemming. Well, word embedding is a technique for converting a word into a vector or array consisting of a set of numbers. With the word embedding technique, word can be converted into a vector containing numbers with a size just small enough to contain more information. The information obtained will be sufficiently large that our vector will be able to detect meaning. Every one word is charted to one vector. One vector is carried out learning which is similar to a neural network model, then combine it in the field of deep learning. If the thing that need to be considered in finding information from a heterogeneous collection of document is a term weighting. Term can be word, phrase, or other indexed units in the document that can be used to find out the context of the document. Because each word has different importance in the document, an indicator is given for each word. The labeling is this clinical statement is described as eligible and not eligible. Eligible means the class of patient who will have to undergo an clinical trial, while not eligible means the class of patient who will not be subject to clinical trial. The basic focus of this research is the application of multilayer perceptron for clinical trial document, referring to the weight of the neuron at the input node and to produce the output using a non-linear mathematical activation function. A linear combination will be constructed by the perceptron by counting the output neuron from several rail. This is the architecture of multilayer perceptron. Result. K-fold cross-validation work by dividing the data into several fold and confirm that each fold is used as a testing set at some point. Table 3 below shows the result of accuracy, precision, recall, and fault score for testing data using 10-fold cross-validation. Is this a snapshot for the data set? And it's the result of testing data 10-fold cross-validation, accuracy, precision, recall, and F1 score. It is the table of result of training data. This is a graph of between training and testing. Result of without and using word embedding feature. Here. Can the active value, precision, recall, and F1 score also not significant of the previous table. Result, word embedding is important in this reset, adding the trained word embedding to the classification adds value to the evaluation. We also use word vector to generate word cluster. The word vector generated were also useful for accurately resolving analogy problem. Conclusion, we have constructed a classification model to improve the classification value of clinical trial text using a multilayer perceptron. The accuracy of the eligibility classification is 75.55%, 76.40%, precision, 74.00% for recall, and F1 score 25.20%. This increase in value occur because of the effect of the embedding. We use circularity measurement in the dataset and from statistics. Our analysis found that this quantitative measure led to transparency in our conclusion. NAC research is a continuation of this research. Variation in research can be created by using a larger dataset or similar dataset and by using other deep learning method, making it possible to conduct research in multiple. We'll back to moderator.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Jasmir, for his informative and interesting talk. Now we will open the floor for a question. If the participants have question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. For other participants, if you have any question regarding to Mr. Jasper presentation, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box.
Let me ask him.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Widodo Chandra. The time is yours.
How do you obtain the data? Yeah, Mr. A, as you stated in your presentation, you have data for when or reading data for data proportion testing data when 2020 or 2021 or next time for 24 or 5 and so on. When I want to ask, how do you obtain the data? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, thank you, Mr. Winoto. I obtain the data from the public data set. I take from the clinicaltrial.gov. I download this data about 1 year ago. We use 100,000 data for this case.
Thank you. Enough.
You're welcome. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Jasmir, for the answers.
Okay, thank you, Mr.
Other participants, if you have any question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, Mr. Jasmir, I think I have several questions for you.
Okay, Mr.
The first question is, as stated in your research methodology, you use word embedding technique and TF-EDF.
Yeah.
How does those two features are used in your paper? And the second question is regarding to your multi-layer perceptron architecture. How you create your multi-layer perceptron architecture? How many the input layers, how many the hidden layers, and how many nodes for the output layers? And the last question is,
One more, Mr. Novak. I want to write your question.
Okay. the first question is, yeah. You use HFIDF and word embedding method for feature extraction.
Yeah.
How does those two features are combined in your paper, or it's just one of them you use to explore your dataset? That's the first question. The second question is regarding to your multi-layer perceptron architecture.
Yeah.
Could you tell us your multi-layer perceptron architecture, such as the input layer nodes, the hidden layer nodes and layers, and then the output layers node?
Yeah.
And my last question is, how does you avoid out of vocabulary phenomena in your dataset, since you use word embedding technique to extract the feature from the text? Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Noval. The first question, how do combine the word embedding in this case? I insert the word embedding before the training. Before the training, and I run with the method multilayer perceptron, and I run using without word embedding with multilayer perceptron, and I run the using word embedding and multilayer perceptron before the training. And number two, MLP is I use the one input and three hidden and one output. Number three, one more, Mister. Number three, the question. One more.
Oh, repeat. For the third question, the third question is how you avoid the out of vocabulary phenomena in your word embedding models. How you avoid out of vocabulary phenomena in your word embeddings model?
Your noise is broken, Mister.
OOV, out of vocabulary phenomena. How you avoid out of vocabulary phenomena in your word embedding models?
How does you avoid
out of vocabulary? OOV.
Vocabulary.
Out of vocabulary.
Okay. I can explain this question. I not yet this try this.
Okay, Mister. It's okay, Mister.
Yeah.
Suggestion for your next research regarding the word embedding and TF-IDF. So I think you have to explore more about out of vocabulary phenomena, since the word embedding models is sensitive to out of vocabulary.
Yeah.
Okay, Mr. Jasmir, we still have time, and we have question from Mr. Revan Muhammad Dafa. Said that I want to ask Mr. Jasmir, it's an interesting paper and nice presentation. And his question is, how algorithm TF-IDF are used when applying the word embedding method. What is the input of the FIDF or word embedding method? And his question, his second question is the FIDF produce a vector that is as long as the total vocabulary of the data. How do you solve the vector that is too long when the data has a lot of vocabulary? So in sum up, the first question is asking about how the FIDF used two word embedding method. So what is the input of the FIDF or word embedding method? That's the first question. So he asks about the input to the FIDF and word embedding method. And the second question is regarding to number of features produced by word embedding by the FIDF. So the numbers of words or the number of features produced by the FIDF since the total features of the FIDF is same or as long as total vocabulary of data. So how do you solve the long vectors features from the FIDF? If you have, do you have any method to reduce the vector?
Yeah, mister, in my data set, one feature, it is a document, the free text, and the next feature is a class. In the document, include the free text, unstructured free text in this data set.
Okay, Mr. Jasmine?
Yeah.
That's your question. That's your answer regarding to Mr. Revan Muhammad Dafa question.
Yes, one feature.
Okay. Mr. Jasmir use one feature factor for one sentence.
The one feature is the document feature in
One feature for one document feature. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you for your answer, Mr. Jasmir.
You're welcome.
Dafa, if you have any further question regarding to Mr. Jasmir answer, please contact him by email. Okay.
Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Jasmir, for your informative and interesting presentation and your answer. Next. Yeah,
thank you, welcome. Thank you, Mr. Revan.
We will have our last presentation. And the last presenters for our first day parallel session is Ms. Nurul Afifah. She will deliver a presentation entitled Clustering Analysis of Teacher Performance Based on Hybrid Fuzzy Semins and PSO Algorithm. Ms. Nurul Afifah, the floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Okay, today I will present of this our research in the title of clustering analysis of teacher performance based on hybrid fuzzy semins and PSO algorithm. Okay, we are team. Are Mr. Albertus Dimas Ananta, Mrs. Dian Palu Pirini, Mr. Kanda Januar Miraswan, and the last is me, Nur Afifa. And I will present our research today, introduction. Okay, why cluster the teacher performance? Okay, the role of teacher in education or teaching and helping develop the school programs. In law number 14 of 2005, teacher is a professional educator with the main task of educating, teaching, guiding, directing, training, and evaluating students in early childhood. Teacher has a very important role and is difficult to be replaced by anyone, even with today's sophisticated technology. So it can be concluded that the performance of professional teacher is the main task of the teacher consists in planning and evaluating learning with predetermining roles. According to the regulation of the Minister of State for Administrative Reform of Bureaucratic Reform number 16 of 2009, teacher performance is an assessment on every item of the teacher's main task activities in the context of career development, rank, and position. Okay, methodology. Okay, this is our methodology. The first is we can do system requirement, and then software development, and then FCM PSO algorithm, and then the last is analysis. Okay, in the system requirement, in the data, the type of data used in this research is primary data, which is in the form of teacher performance assessment report data at Saverius 1 High School, Saverius 3 High School, and the last is Saverius 4 High School. The amount of data used is plain as much as, it's false, 120 teacher performance assessment data. Okay, in the software development, the first task is inception phase, and then elaboration phase, construction phase, and the last is transition phase. In the inception phase, we can do the determines the user requirements and functionality or feature needed in the software. At this stage of need collection, the author collected research data in the form of teacher performance assessment data obtained from questionnaires. At the analysis and design stage, we create a use case diagram. At the implementation stage, document user requirement, software functionality, and use case diagram. And then the second stage is elaboration phase. In this stage, we can do determine the software architecture, database design, and interface design. Okay, and the user requirement and software functionality that has been obtained, we can complete the user requirement. And we can compile documentation containing software architecture, database design, and etc. Okay, in the third phase is construction phase. In this stage, we can do the determine the classes needed in the software. At this stage of gathering needs, it's determined the programming language used to develop the software. We use Java. And the last stage is transition phase. In this stage, we create a plan or scenario in the testing of the software. We determine the necessary testing tools in the need collection stage. Testing tools are the same hardware. We use laptop. And we are use the software compiler NetBeans. Okay, why FCM PSO? Okay, because the basic concept of fuzzy SIMINS was to determine the cluster center as the average location of each cluster. Each data point has membership for each cluster. The center of the cluster is still inaccurate. Therefore, a process is carried out to improve the cluster center for each data. So the cluster center will move to the right location. This iteration process is based on the minimization of the objective function that describes the distance from the data. The problem has motivated us to make the research to cluster the performance of teacher using hybrid fuzzy SIMINS and PSO algorithm with new data set. Okay, an FGM PSO algorithm was applied while tree was a local optimization problem. So the solution was to find out optimal solutions. And in the case of large number of cluster, initial values was influenced the speed of convergence. In this work, it applies FGM PSO to cluster the teacher performance. In FGM PSO, the core of FGM algorithm was to determine the clustering center. So PSO will code the clustering center. The procedure of in the performance measure, we can do the we determine the third scenario. In the first scenario, we do the iterations, and the second scenario in a particle. In the last scenario, is the acceleration coefficient. Okay, in the result, we can get the five cluster. The first assessment is very good. The second is good. And the third assessment is pretty good. The fourth is medium, and the last is deficient. Okay, this is the validation using the Excel, small example of the result. Okay, you can see in the number one example, Dr. Andes Alexander Koharman is the man from Saverius III High School, Palembang. And then in the actual data amat baik, and the system data amat baik. And then the result is true. Like this. Okay, this is the attribute. We have 14 attribute to measure the performance of teacher, and then we cluster the with the five cluster. Very good, good, pretty good, medium, and deficient. Okay, I think that's all. We can back the to moderator, Opal. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much, Ms. Nurul Afifah, for her informative and interesting talk. Now we will open the floor for a question. If the audience have question, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, for audience, if you have any question regarding to Ms. Nurul Afifah presentation, please raise your hand or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, Ms. Nurul Afifah, let me ask question for you. As you state in the title of your paper and presentation, it states that clustering analysis of teacher performance. So your works is about clustering analysis, right?
Yes.
But in your result and discussion, I found that you use classification performance measurement, such as true positive, true negative, and etc. And as far as I know, those matrices are used for classification problem. So how do you, what is your answer regarding to your title and your performance evaluation? Thank you.
Okay. I will answer from novel question. Okay, in our title is clustering the teacher performance based on hybrid FGM PSO and algorithm. Okay, I will answer. In the result, we can get the confusion matrix true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negative. Okay. In this assessment is the cluster of the result from FCM, PSO. Okay. This is from the scenario. We are fine-tuning in the third scenario. The first is from iteration. Okay, we fine-tuning the from 100 iteration until 3,000 iteration. Okay, from the parameter iteration, we can get the has many accuracy. The first accuracy is 50% with the 100 iteration, but in the last iteration with 3,000 iteration, we can get the 88.33% accuracy. Okay, in the we are title clustering, we use the FCM fuzzy chain-means. Fuzzy chain-means, the output is the cluster of the assessment. So in the result, the assessment is very good, good, pretty good, medium, and deficient. This is the result of the clustering. But true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negative, we are get from the correct data and incorrect data. Okay, in the third scenario, we can get the correct data. In 120 data, we can get zero incorrect data. So the accuracy is 100% with execution time 232.748 execution time. So in the output of the clustering, we can get the five cluster, true positive, true negative, false positive, and false negative is the correct data and incorrect data. It will go like this.
Okay, thank you for your answer, Mr. Nurul Afifah. So to sum up your answers, so you do the clustering first, and then you have five clusters, right?
Yes.
And then you label those clusters into very good, good, and etc. And yes, then you compare it to the labeled data.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, Miss Nurul Afifah, for answer regarding to my question. We still have time. If other audience have question, please raise your hand, or you can write it down in the chat box. Okay, Ms. Nurul Afifah, thank you for your presentation and your answers. Ladies and gentlemen, finally, we come to the end of first day parallel session presentation. We would like to say thanks again for all the presenters for their informative and interesting talk, and to audience for your active participation. Hopefully, the presentation will be beneficial for everybody. We will continue the presentation in the next following days. Thank you for your attention. Good afternoon. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Salam.